All right. Thank you, Titus. Good morning to everyone. Good to see you all here. We have a. We're going to start a new chapter. We're starting the third and final chapter of Paul's epistle to Titus. We'll be studying Titus chapter 3, verse 1. And this is a great study. It kind of parallels our study. Remember, for those of you who were with me at Prairie View when we did Romans, Romans 13, the first eight verses were about, first seven verses were about the Christian's responsibilities to the civil governmental authorities. So Titus 3:1 is pretty much parallels that passage, because in this passage, Titus 3:1, Paul instructs Titus to remind the Cretan Christian community of their responsibility to their governmental rulers or authorities. So it's a great subject for us. Chapter 3 is a little bit different from the first two chapters in the sense that in the first two chapters we saw Paul talked about what the Christians' responsibility were toward each other and the Christian community. And now in chapter 3, he talks about our responsibilities outside the Christian community with the non-Christians and with the governmental rulers and authorities. So a very important class here, and it's connected. This whole chapter 3, verses 1 through 8, is also, in a way, Paul's thrust is for evangelism, too, as we'll see. Because our godly conduct is going to can be used by God to lead people to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. So for that purpose also, not just for our own purposes, but for the evangelization of the people in our area, around us, and even the leaders in our civil governmental authority, it's a very important class. So we're going to also, just a reminder for those who are not familiar with the ministry, our class schedule is Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, and of course, Sunday morning. The weekday classes, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday, are in the book of Daniel. We're approaching the end of chapter 11. There's 12 chapters in the book, and so we'll be finishing that book probably sometime at the beginning of September. Then we'll be I don't know what we're going to do in between, but the next book we're going to do after Daniel is going to be 2 Timothy. And then I haven't decided. I have a couple of ideas as far as what I'm going to do after Titus, and I don't know yet what I'm going to do as subjects in between the books, which I'm undoubtedly going to have a study of some couple of subjects between Titus and the next book we do. So each class, for those who are unfamiliar with the ministry, each class is different. We go verse by verse through the different books of the Bible. The weekday classes, the study through the book of Daniel, and then also, which is doing very good, by the way, on our website. We're getting a good following of that, not just for the audio and the video, but also it's very popular with the written articles. And also Titus, as well, during Sundays, is doing very well as far as the hits on the website. And also, our website is www.wenstrom.org. And we're going to also have a couple of things related to a good friend of mine. Her name's Cheyenne Autumn Thompson, a friend of all of you. She's going to be going away for 2 weeks. She leaves. She's going to leave today around noontime, and she's going to this Christian camp. I thought it was a camp for bad kids, and Titus Jody said, hey, I'm going to send them away for this bad kid, but that's not the case. Cheyenne's a very good kid. I don't want the world to know that she's a very good kid, excellent kid like her brother. And so she's going away to camp for 2 weeks, two long weeks. I don't know. I'm going to miss her. So so keep her in prayer, and also keep her brother in prayer, because I don't know what's going to happen with the chores that Cheyenne has. He double duty might for this poor guy. So this guy, when she comes back, will probably be kissing her feet when she walks in the door, doing everything for his sister, because he had dishpan hands. You might want to. I have some extra, yellow gloves you might use, so you won't get that dishpan hand thing. You know, I hate when that happens. So, my buddy Tyler, keep him in prayer. The other thing is also we're going to have for a congregational song at the beginning. We're going to do "Amazing Grace," and that's on page 11. But I'm going to have Cheyenne's going to come up and sing along with me. We're going to do a little duet together. So. Hopefully I don't mess up the words for her. I got the words right here, so you never know. I could choke it and stuff. So she's going to help me come up and do that song with all of us. So that's about it for the announcements. Let's take a moment of silent prayer to prepare ourselves. Remember, the Father wants us to worship Him and His Son by means of the Spirit and truth. And so this, to ensure the fact that this does take place, we usually take a moment of silent prayer before the beginning of class, which is a time to be alone with God and to have the Holy Spirit convict us of any sins that we need to confess, that we haven't confessed since our last confession to our Heavenly Father. 1 John 1:9 states, if we confess our sins to the Father, He, God the Father, is faithful and just to forgive us our sins, with the result that He purifies us from each and every wrongdoing, even the sins that we commit out of ignorance of the Word of God. Now, the reason why it's a simple confession restores us to fellowship with God is because of the merits of Jesus Christ and His death on the cross. So when you say, Father, I confess this sin, whatever it is, the Father's going to forgive you because of what His Son did at the cross. Now, you might say, well, when I became a Christian, didn't I get on with the forgiveness of my sins then? Yes, you did. But you still have a sin nature. You and I still live in the devil's world, so we do sin. So God is still holy. So because of fellowship, in communion with God, we need to confess our sins. Our eternal relationship is not affected by sin, but it does affect our fellowship with God. So as I pointed out in the past, the analogy, the best analogy I can come up with, I'm in the Wenstrom family, and disobeying my parents didn't result in my parents disowning me or kicking me out of the family. But they did. It did affect my communion with them, and fellowship with them. So until I acknowledged my guilt and then did what they told me to do, I wasn't going to have fellowship with them. I wasn't going to have dinner with them. So that's in the same way God has His family. You and I are in that family. He loves us unconditionally. But if He's going to have fellowship with us, because He's holy, we need to make sure that we're in fellowship with God and experiencing His holiness. In fellowship with God. So with that being said, with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this beautiful morning that You've given to us, and we thank You so much for all Your children that are here this morning, that are not only here in the Thompson household, but those who might be viewing or listening to this class through our website and other parts of this country and the world, or on Pal Talk at this particular time. We thank You for each and every one of them. We also thank You for Titus and Jody Thompson opening up their home to us and their hospitality. We thank You for Titus's work with the sound and the recordings, the video, the audio, and we thank You for the technology, and we pray that You would give him wisdom in that area today. And we also, thank You for our relationship with You, Father, and the fact that we're in union with Your Son, Jesus Christ, that we're married to Him, and we look forward to the day that we're perfected in a resurrection body, and we live in trying to live our lives in light of the imminent return of Your Son at the rapture. We know that it could happen today and right as we speak, so help us to live our lives in light of that fact, or our death, which is also imminent. We don't know the day of our death, so help us to live each moment in fellowship with You, making the most of the time, talent, and treasure, and truth, and mind and body You've given us. Help us to be good stewards with these things so that we can receive a full reward. Help us to trust in Your word and not to be anxious about anything. Help us to rest in Your promises, rest in Your love, knowing that when You sent Your Son to the cross for us when we were enemies, and now that we're in Your family through faith in Your Son, You say You're going to freely give us all things. We believe that. So help us, Father, to seek Your kingdom and Your Son's righteousness by learning and applying Your word in our daily lives. We pray, Father, that we this morning in our Bible class and everything that goes on, the singing, the giving, the fellowship after, the meal that we have after, we just pray, Father, that everything would bring glory to You, that everyone will do things in the power of the Spirit. We pray, Father, that You would help all those in the audience to understand what is being taught today. Help them to apply what they're learning. We also pray that You would give grace to myself as the communicator, as the pastor. Help me to communicate to Your people everything You want them to hear so that I'm being used as Your instrument. We pray that the Spirit would not only work powerfully and mightily through myself, but also Your people in the audience who are serious students of the Word of God. Father, we Pray, Father, also for the song service. We pray that it would bring glory to you and that we'd enjoy ourselves in worshiping you through song. In our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name we pray, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. All right, we're going to have, as I said before, Cheyenne's going to come up and sing Amazing Grace with me up here as I lead you guys in singing it. So we'll just give us a sec to get all set up here. And Amazing Grace is on page 11 in your songbooks.
Hello.
Can you give me one of those picks? Pick. No. There you go. Thank you. Can you see that all right? Can you all rise, please? Right?
Amazing grace, how sweet a sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. It was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Twas grace that taught me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, God's praise than when we first begun. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
Thank you. Good job, Cheyenne. Very good. Thank you. Thanks, Cheyenne. We'll let you know, Cheyenne, and we'll let you know when we're doing Vegas, when our tour starts. So thanks, Cheyenne, for doing that. You did a great job. All right, we should be at Titus chapter 3, verse 1. What I want to do is I'm going to read from the New American Standard. You can read from your Bibles. Let's read this section that begins in Titus 3, 1, and then go back to verse 1 and look at that in detail. So we see verse 1 in its context, we say. So Titus chapter 3, verses 1 through 8, I'll read all the way through. So he says, remind them to be subject to rulers, to authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good deed, to malign no one, to be peaceable, gentle, showing every consideration for all men. For we also once were foolish ourselves, disobedient, deceived, enslaved to various lusts and pleasures, spending our life in malice and envy, hateful, hating one another. But when the kindness of God our Savior and his love for mankind appeared, he saved us, not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy, by the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit, whom the Holy Spirit, he, the Father, poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, so that being justified by his grace, we would be made heirs according to the hope of eternal life. And then he says in verse 8, this is a trustworthy statement, and concerning these things I want you to speak confidently, so that those who have believed God, the Christian, will be careful to engage in good deeds. These things are good and profitable for men. And those good deeds are in relation, in that context, to other people who are not Christians. So first two chapters, when he talks about good deeds, it's usually in relation to your fellow Christians. But when we get to chapter 3, he talks about good deeds that we need to practice in relation to our non-Christian neighbors. So this is, again, this is connected to evangelism. And if you heard me talk about this before, and this passage supports this as well, is that we talk about evangelization, we're thinking about talking to people one-on-one with the gospel or a group of people, but the evangelization process actually involves both the communication, the verbal, the communication of the gospel, and also you and I living out the gospel in our daily lives. So in this, living out the gospel in our daily lives involves being obedient, good citizens in our country, being respectful and obedient to the local, federal, and state, federal, state, and local governments, authorities. That involves that. And also being a good neighbor in helping your neighbors out and helping people in your periphery that are non-Christians. So this is a great class for this ministry, and for all Christians for that matter. Now, if you look at Titus 3:1 in detail with me, we'll look at that. That's our subject here this morning. Remind them, he says, to be subject to rulers, to authorities, to be obedient, to be ready for every good work. Now, remember, Paul's talking to Titus, and of course, them is referring to the Cretan Christian community. And Titus was Paul's delegate to that church. So when he says remind them, it's an interesting word that's translated remind there. It's correctly translated. It's the word hupomineskomai. And this word is a cool word because hupomineskomai, it means remind, and it means to remind somebody of something, to bring something to someone's attention. And it indicates Paul wants Titus to remind the Cretan Christian community of their responsibilities to their governmental rulers slash authorities. Now, the words in the present imperative form, this word, hupomineskomai, it actually is a customary present imperative. And that's important for us because it tells us how often they were to do this. Not once a month or something. It's something that they were to habitually to do. The present imperative form of this verb means that Titus was to simply continue making it his habit of reminding the Cretan church to be subject to their governmental rulers and authorities. Now, when he says to be obedient, we look later on, and to be ready, it means a habitual activity as well. So here he's talking about Titus's responsibility to tell the Cretan Christian church, I want you to make it your habit to obey your governmental authorities. Now, again, the word them there, which is the intensive personal pronoun autos, it's referring to the Cretan church. So though he's writing specifically to the Cretan church, what he has to say here is true of all Christians. So we see this particular command that we have in Titus 3:1. also found in Romans chapter 13. So when he says to authorities, he says remind them to be subject to rulers, to authorities. Interesting. When it says to rulers and to authorities, it looks like there is two different levels of authority here being mentioned by Paul. And that's not the case. What I mean by that is that when he talks about rulers, they're the same things as the authorities, as I'll point out. And I'll show you why that is. So he's talking about people in authority from different perspectives. So the first word to rulers, it's the word arche, which pertains to human governmental rulers or authority. It would mean not just President Obama, but also the Senate, the Congress, police officers, local government officials, state government governmental official, you know, people who are in authority, a police officer. So this is the idea. It's a very broad term. Now, the word for authorities is word exousia. It refers to the civil governmental authorities in Rome and also in Crete who were delegated authority and power by God as his servants to govern the affairs of men and to exercise justice against lawbreakers. So our governmental leaders, whether they recognize it or not, are actually servants of God. We said in our study of Daniel, we saw that God called Nebuchadnezzar his servant for different reason than what Paul calls the Roman authorities God's servant. But every governmental leader, whether it's federal, state, local governmental leaders, even the police officer, and in other law enforcement agencies who are trying to are in authority and to are designed to punish lawbreakers and to catch the lawbreakers and to protect us from the enemy within, God has put them in position whether they recognize it or not. We need to know that. So that's why it's very, very important that we show every respect to the governmental authorities. So this word that's translated authorities, it's the word exousia, as I said before. It's synonymous with the word arche, which is translated here rulers. And it's functioning as this word exousia, authorities, is functioning as a dative of simple apposition in Greek grammar. And that's important because it's saying that this word, authorities, is actually clarifying what Paul means by the word rulers. So that's the grammar is telling us that authorities is explaining specifically what Paul means by these rulers. So therefore, the two words are not distinguishing different levels of authority, but rather they're both speaking of all civil governmental authority, which is indicated by the fact that if Paul was distinguishing levels of authority here, he would have employed the conjunction chi, which is and in English, and he would use the word and between the two words. So what I mean by that is if he was distinguishing between two different levels of authority, he would do this: remind them to be subject to rulers and to authorities. But he doesn't do that. He's not distinguishing the two. He's not saying that they're different levels of authority, because if he did, he would put the word and between the two words. He doesn't do that. So also the other reason why I say that they're both referring to the same thing, rulers and authorities, is that in Romans 13:1, where Paul addresses the responsibilities of the Roman believers to the civil authorities, Roman civil authorities, he doesn't use the word translated rulers, arche, for governmental authorities, but rather he employs the word exousia, which would indicate that in the apostles' mind, both words speak of the governmental authorities in the Roman Empire. So when he says to rulers and authorities, in Romans 13:1, he doesn't use the word for rulers, arche. He uses exousia, authorities. So if you look at Romans 13:1, let me show you this. Hold your place. We'll probably go back there a couple times. But this is important because he's not talking about different levels of authority. He's talking about one and the same group of people. And it's very broad. So Romans 13:1, look what he says. Romans 13:1, every person is to be in subjection to the governmental authorities. For there's no authority except from God, and those who exist are established by God. Doesn't that sound just like what Paul says in Titus 3:1? It does, right? Because he's using the same language, except for one thing. You notice how he says governmental authorities there in Romans 13:1? That's the word exousia. The word for authority, exousia. Now, when Paul uses in Titus 3:1, He uses this word exousia. And for the same group of people that he's talking about in Romans 13:1. When he says in Romans 13:1, every person is to be in subjection to the governmental authorities, exousia, that's everybody. Federal, state, local level levels of government he's talking about. Everybody who's in an authority in our country is what he would be talking about. Now, he doesn't use the word for translated rulers, arche. So when he does that, if you look at Titus 3:1 now, basically, in his mind, in Paul's mind, the reason why I compare the two is that Paul is using, in Romans 13:1, where Paul addresses the responsibilities of the Roman believers to the Roman civil authorities, he doesn't use the word rulers for governmental authorities, but he does use the word governmental authorities, exousia, which would indicate that in the apostle's mind, both words speak of the governmental authorities in the Roman Empire. He could have used both words in Romans 13:1 like he does in Titus 3:1, but he doesn't. But so therefore, when he talks about in Titus 3:1, remind them to be subject to rulers, to authorities. Authorities is giving us a little bit a different insight into what he means by rulers. So he's not talking about two levels of authority here. Rulers and authorities in Titus 3:1 are referring to the same group of people. So therefore, what Paul's doing here, he's clarifying for Titus in the Cretan Christian community that when he talks about them obeying the governmental authorities or rulers, he does not mean those in the highest echelons of government, but all those in positions of authority in the Roman Empire. So the word rulers there, arche, that's usually, a lot of times, used for someone who's in a high position. It's a very high position, whether it's spiritual or, you know, in a civil setting and with unbelievers. But it talks about someone who's like the archangel. You ever hear the word term archangel? Like Michael is an archangel. That means he's a ruler angel. What we see here is that Paul's not talking about highest echelons of people in government. He's talking about anybody who's connected to authority in the government, whether it's Romans national government, the Romans in authority in Crete, or anywhere in the Roman Empire. Those people in authority, he's talking about, I want you to be subject to them, be obedient to them. So we have here, Paul's telling us, I'm not just distinguishing between levels of government. Like, for instance, what I'm saying is Titus 3:1, he says, remind them to be subject to rulers. He's not saying, okay, he wants us to obey the president. He's talking about, I want you to obey the president and everybody else who's in authority. That's the idea here. So then he says, let's get to further. Thank you for bearing me. I just wanted to clarify that with you so you understand what the text is saying. That's my job, is to tell you what the text is saying. So sometimes we might have to change the translation because it might not be accurate. Now, when it says remind them to be subject to rulers, to authorities, the word subject is a great word. It's the word hupotassomai, which denotes that the Cretan Christian community was to submit to the authority of their governmental rulers and authorities, and which authority was delegated to the governmental authorities and rulers by God. So this verb is used in the same manner in relation to the Cretan Christian community, or the Christians Christian community, and their responsibilities to the governmental authorities. It's found in Romans 13:1, as we just looked at, and it's also found in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 13 and 14. Now, let me show you these two passages, a couple of them here. Go back to Romans 13:1. Paul talks extensively about obeying people in authority. Look at Romans 13:1. We're going to read all the way through verse 7. And then we're going to go to 1 Peter. So Romans 13:1, Paul talks, in Titus 3:1, he just talks in passing to them about obeying governmental authorities, you know, federal, state, local government, police officer, but it's very brief. But when you get to Romans 13, he actually develops it further. And mind you, what he says in Romans 13 to the Roman believers, who he had not met yet when he wrote this, he taught this to the Cretan Christian community. Titus taught these things that he's teaching in Romans 13. He taught the Christian church on the island of Crete these things all the time. They heard this all the time. So Romans 13:1, every person is to be in subjection to the governmental authorities, for there is no authority except from God. And those who exist, which exist, are established by God. God establishes every form of government that we have here. Human government came into existence because of God. This goes back to when Noah left the ark. Prior to Noah, prior to the flood, anarchy reigned. There was no establishment of human government, and there was anarchy, and the earth was destroyed because of the anarchy and the rebellion against God. So when Noah and his sons left the ark, God established human government when he said, anybody who kills somebody, an innocent person, cold-blooded murder, they're to be executed. That was the establishment of human government. Human government has been established by God to punish the lawbreakers. So therefore, he doesn't want us as individuals to be seeking, you know, vigilantism. And that's what was going on prior to the flood. There was a lot of this vigilante thing going on, people killing each other. You killed my brother, I'm coming after you. God didn't want that. He wanted people in power, in governmental setting, to be the ones that bring to justice the person who's a criminal, whether they're a murderer or a kidnapper or whatnot. So this is very important. So he doesn't, that's why, you know, people say, how do you reconcile this, Pastor Bill? You say forgive other people, like the murderer, forgive them, but yet you're saying you abide by capital punishment. You're not forgiving them. Oh, I am forgiving them. But God has established civil government to be the one that carries out the punishment of the criminal. I'm not to do it on my own. God has established governmental authorities to do that for me. And that's the main role that they have. And we're not having that accomplished in our country today and in many places. We don't believe in capital punishment in this country anymore. And that's why we have the mess we have with all the crime. Capital punishment, it's a deterrent to crime, according to the Bible. Does that mean that everybody will be deterred by that? No. But it does definitely deter crime. So our governmental leaders are going to be held to account for this, by the way. And so nobody's getting away with anything. So look at verse 2 now. Therefore, whoever resists authority has opposed the ordinance of God, and they who have opposed will receive condemnation upon themselves. So if we're out there robbing and stealing and stuff, committing murder, breaking the law, you know, you will be punished, and there, God has put people in authority, men in authority and women in authority, to do that, to carry out the punishment of lawbreakers. So God likes law and order. Verse 3, for rulers are not a cause for fear for good behavior, but for evil. I like to use this example. When you're riding down the highway and you're looking for the police officer, why don't you stick it on cruise and follow the speed limit? Because the speed limit is there to protect you. And the people who break the speed limit are going to be caught by the police and you're going to get a ticket. And God doesn't want us to be riding around breaking the speed limit. For a long time, I didn't get that. But that's part of this, what he's talking about. So you won't have fear of being caught by the police if you're following, you know, the speed limit. You know, I was driving with a family member, and they used to have this, they don't have it anymore, probably because of what I said. But anyways, they used to have this thing, you know, it's to text the police around. Well, you know, I said, you know, if you just did, you know, abide by the rules, of the, you know, you have a, what do they call that? A radar? Not a radar. They had a radar, but I'm saying you got the cruise control. Use the cruise control. That's perfect. Find the speed limit. This is what I do. Find the speed limit and stick it on cruise. I mean, for the longest time, I didn't do that. I broke the law, too. So I'd say to the person, why do you need that? Just follow the rule, follow the, you know, what the speed limit says. You know, it's like, so this is part of what it's talking about here. So you won't have to fear the police pulling you over if you go in the speed limit. You know, it used to be for a long time, I always look in the rearview mirrors, police coming after me, you know. Now, because I follow the speed limit, if the police are coming after me, got to be some serious thing going on here because I'm going by the speed limit. And the other thing is to save your life, by the way, speed limit. So verse 3, for rulers are not a cause of fear for good behavior, but for evil. Do you want to have no fear of authority? Do what is good. Abide the speed limit. Abide the rules of the road. Obey the laws of the land. Do what is good and you will have praise from the same. For it, the governmental authority, is a minister of God to you for good. So civil government, federal, state, local government, the police officer, they're there for your good. And I'll have something to say about people who don't do a good job in that area. So he says, for it is a minister of God to you for good, but if you do what is evil, breaking the law, be afraid, for it does not bear the sword for nothing. For it is a minister, the government, is a minister of God, an avenger who brings wrath on the one who practices evil, the lawbreaker, like the murderer, the kidnapper. Therefore, it is necessary to be in subjection. Same word we see in Romans 3:1, hupotassomai. Not only because of wrath, but also for conscience sake. You're a Christian, God established those governmental authority, people in government, and to protect you and to, from the enemy, from within, the lawbreakers. So for conscience sake, you and I should be obeying the laws of the land, being law-abiding citizens. Verse 6, for because of this, you also pay taxes. For rulers are servants of God. President Obama is a servant, whether they're Democrat, Republican, Libertarian, Independent, everybody in a governmental position is a servant of God. Everyone. Now, all servants have to give an account to their master. Well, President Obama will have to give an account for his job, just like everybody else that's been in power or is in power now or will be in power in the future, whether it's in America or Russia or China, okay? Everybody is working for God. Now, some aren't doing a good job for God and some are. So verse 6, for because of this, you also pay taxes, for rulers are servants of God, devoting themselves to this very thing. Render to all what is due them. Tax to whom tax is due, custom to whom custom, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. Now, that's very similar. Remember what Jesus said when they try to trap him? And he says, well, render to Caesar that which is Caesar's and to God which is God. Basically saying the same thing that Paul just said, pretty much. Basically, give to Caesar what is owed to Caesar and give to God what is owed to God. Obedience to both. So that's now look at 1 Peter. Hop over to 1 Peter. It's after Titus. It's after James. Look at 1 Peter chapter 2. Look at verse 13. Now, it's interesting, you know, What do you do when the people who are in authority, you know, are not good? They're not doing their job. They're evil and everything. Well, first of all, God will take care of them. But, you know, unless the government is telling you their laws are conflicting with the laws of God, like let me give you an example. If the United States comes out and say, all right, no more teaching the gospel, no more praying for you Christians. Well, we have to obey God rather than the government then. So that's called justified civil disobedience. That's not happening right now in our country. That might someday. So unless the laws of the land conflict with the laws of God, we're to obey the governmental leaders. Now listen to me. When Paul wrote what he wrote in Titus 3 and what he wrote in Romans 13, and when Peter wrote as we're going to read in 1 Peter 2, guess who was in power in Rome at that time? One of the most wicked people in the history of the world, Nero. Nero ends up eventually executing Paul. Also, he tortured and murdered many Christians. In fact, as it goes, in the mid-60s of the first century, he went out, mid to late part of the 60s of the first century, Nero was a great builder, and Nero wanted to rebuild Rome, a lot of Rome. So what he had this bright idea is he had people set the city on fire so he could rebuild it the way he wanted to. And you know who he blamed it on? And even we have writings from secular historians like Tacitus who say that the Christians were blamed for it by Nero, and everybody knows the Christians didn't do it. So they were unjustly treated by the civil authorities. So before that all went down, Paul knew who was in power, and yet he told them to obey the civil authorities. The only time they were to disobey the civil authorities, like Nero, is if Nero or somebody in the Roman government said, don't preach the gospel, don't pray. You know, Daniel, remember in the book of Daniel, our studies during the week, Daniel was, the laws of the land said you can't pray to your God for a month. Daniel continued to pray. He was executed for it, and God delivered him from the lion's den. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And Daniel chapter 3, Daniel's three friends. Nebuchadnezzar, who ends up eventually becoming a believer, he goes and he says, worship an image of me. a golden image of me, 90 feet high. They said no. And they were executed, and God delivered them from the flames. And then Nebuchadnezzar got saved because of that. So we don't have that going on in our country right now. Someday we might. So in the meantime, we had to render obedience to our governmental authorities. And let me tell you something, another thing, and I'm going to show you this passage in a minute. We shouldn't be spreading, passing emails around or on Facebook, passing these things around, attacking the president or his character, or his family, or we can disagree with his policies. We have that right. We can vote these people out that we don't think are doing a good job. Thank God we have that right. But we don't have a right. We're at a higher level as Christians. We are held to a higher standard than the world. We are not to speak evil of our president. We can vote him out, but we shouldn't be spreading garbage and gossip. Many times the things people spread around about the president, and I'm not saying I'm a Democrat or Republican or anything. I see this, they did this to President Bush as well, the other side. There's this email stuff that goes on, and it's from people who are right-wing, left-wing, and they're both bashing each other and trying to say stuff about the other. And you got to understand where that's coming from. We're not to get involved in that stuff. You know, we're to obey the authorities. And so, in fact, listen to a man who was once the former chaplain. This is a quote from a former chaplain of the United States Senate. Former chaplain of the United States Senate. Listen to what he has to say. To be sure, men will abuse and misuse the institution of the state, meaning they'll misuse being an authority. They'll be bad leaders. So he says, to be sure, men will abuse and misuse the institution of the state, just as a man, because of sin, is abused and misused every other institution in history, including the Church of Jesus Christ. But this does not mean that the institution is bad or that it should be forsaken. It simply means that men are sinners and rebels in God's world, and this is the way they behave with good institutions. So there he's saying, that's the rest of the quote, that's the last of the quote, but there's the rest of it. And he says, he goes on to say, this is where I want to see. Okay, good. Then he goes, as a matter of fact, it is because of this very sin that there must be a human government to maintain order in history until the final and ultimate rule of Jesus Christ is established. Human government is better than anarchy, and the Christian must recognize the divine right, quote unquote, of the state, end of quote. That's the former chaplain of the United States Senate. So he's saying, yeah, men are sinners. That's why we have bad leaders and leaders who abuse their authority. But that it's better to have bad leaders than no leaders at all and have anarchy. So somebody might say, well, what about Hitler? Well, this is what I would say about Hitler, is that if Hitler is telling me to kill Jews, or I know that he's gathering up the Jews and he's going to kill them, I'm going to keep those Jews from Hitler and I'll break the law. And that's what a lot of Christians did, and some didn't, because of fear of Hitler. So you, again, it's just like the Hebrew midwives. They were told by Pharaoh to kill the baby boys. Remember that? The Egyptian baby boys? And they disobeyed Pharaoh. So we don't have that going on in this country, thank God. Maybe someday we will, but we don't have it going on now. So we have to, as Halverson says, we have to recognize the divine right of our governmental leaders. So look at 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13. 1 Peter 2:13. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human institution, federal, state, and local governments, the town, the police officer. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake, do it for him, to every human institution, whether to a king as the one in authority, or like the president, we would say, we don't have kings, or to governors as sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and the praise of those who do right. For such is the will of God, that by doing right, you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. What does he mean by that? There are people criticizing Christianity, and Peter says, by your good conduct toward the civil authorities, they will have no reason to criticize us Christians. But when we are anarchists, or we're bad citizens, we're giving unbelievers an opportunity to ridicule us Christians. And therefore, we And they end up blaspheming our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So just being a law-abiding citizen and paying your taxes and obeying the laws of the land, you're bringing honor and glory to God. And then the other thing is, we're to pray for our leaders. Back up to 1 Timothy. You were in Titus. Right before Titus, you have 2nd, and then there's 1 Timothy. Look at 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. We should be praying for our leaders. Yeah, I'll tell you something as a Christian. Listen to me carefully. We do not abide by what Fox Television or CNN says or MSN or anybody says. We abide with what the Bible says as Christians. We're held to that standard. We don't want to follow what the rest of the world does and who's always rebellious against authority and speaks evil of their leaders. We should never be involved in that as Christians. And if you have, and I have in the past, and it was wrong. If you have, don't do it again. Just stop doing it and move on. And if people don't bother reading the emails or looking at Facebook things where they're totally disobeying that and they're Christians. We're not talking about the unbelievers. We're talking about Christians, how we're supposed to act to our governmental leaders. So look at 1 Timothy 2:1. Let's pray for them. First of all, then, I urge that entreaties and prayers and petitions and thanksgiving be made on behalf of all men for kings, or we could say presidents, because we don't have kings right now, and all who are in authority, so that we may lead a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. Meaning, it's for your own benefit that you pray for your leaders, because they're under attack from the kingdom of darkness. Remember, Satan's the god of this world, and he's trying to deceive our leaders into doing stupid things. So they need prayer. The Democrats, Republican, Independent, Libertarian, they all need prayer. This is good to do this and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. You know, so if you're a Republican and you have a problem with Hillary Clinton or the president, why aren't you praying for them? Why don't you pray that they get exposed to the gospel? You know, they're human beings too that need Jesus, right? That's, we got to look past the political garbage. They're humans as well, with a great authority. But what's our job? Let's pray for them. Because God desires all men to be saved. We should pray for everyone, even for the party we don't like. So then he goes on to say that God desires all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator also between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, including our leaders, the testimony given at the proper time. Now go back to Titus. Hop back over to Titus. Titus chapter 3, verse 1. So Paul says in Titus 3:1, remind them to be subject to rulers, to authorities. The word to be subject, as we said before, is the Greek word hupotassomai, and it denotes that the Cretan Christian community was to submit to the authority of their governmental rulers and authorities, and which authority was delegated to the governmental authorities and rulers by God. Now this verb, as we just seen, is used in the same manner in Romans 13:1 and 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 13. Now in Titus 3:1, we have a present tense of this verb. It's what we call a customary present. It talks about habitual activity. So it's what he's saying to the Cretan Christian community is, he's telling Titus, instruct the Cretan Christian community to remind them to make it their habit of being subject to their governmental rulers and authorities. Basically, this should be a regularly occurring thing. This is a lifestyle for us, that we're subject to our governmental leaders. Now, the word for to be obedient, it's in the Greek, it's the word patharkeo, which pertains to submitting to a legitimate authority by obeying, and it's used, of course, in reference to the Cretan Christian community, obeying the governmental leaders. So, in other words, what he's doing here, he's with the word to be obedient, he's explaining how you're to be subject to your rulers and authorities. You do it by being obedient. So when he says to be obedient, that's defining what he means to be subject to your governmental leaders. To be obedient here is also in the present tense. It's a customary present, means that Paul wants the Christians on the island of Crete to make it their habit of being obedient to their governmental leaders. Now, the words in the infinitive form, this word petharkao, it's an infinitive means in Greek grammar, and that's important for us because it's describing how or the way in which the Cretan Christian church was to make it their habit of voluntarily subjecting themselves to the governmental rulers, indicating that they were to do so by obeying them. So again, when he says to be obedient, he's explaining with that phrase what it means to be subject to the governmental leaders, the governmental rulers slash authorities. Then we have the final phrase of the sentence is related to obeying the law, really, and helping other people out who are non-Christians. He says to be ready, Romans Titus 3:1, remind them to be subject to rulers, to authorities, to be obedient. Then he says to be ready for every good deed. To be ready for every good deed means that the Cretan Christian church was to be in a state of readiness for any kind of good deed or action or work. So this, what he's meaning is like, let's say a tornado hit somewhere. And I remember when we were at Prairie View, some of the Christians in our church, they went down. Remember that place they got decked? Oh, it was terrible. Fredericksburg. Was it Fredericksburg?
Or Parkersburg.
What is it?
Parkersburg.
I'm sorry. Thank you. That was a terrible tornado. Well, some of our people went down there to help those people out. That's what he's talking about here. Be ready for any good deed. So if we see somebody in need that's at, you know, anywhere, any of our neighbors, we're not just talking Christians. Whether they're unbelievers or non or Christians, we're to be ready to lend a hand. We should be one of the kind of the people in our community where people say they're always there ready to lend a hand. They're always ready to do a good deed. That's what he's talking about. Now, these good deeds, what does he mean, a good deed? The word deed means action. The word good means it's divine in quality and character. So he's saying, I want you to do actions that are good in quality, divine in quality and character. Good. Now, how do you do that? Well, the Bible says, for instance, the Holy Spirit says through the Bible says, love your neighbor as yourself. So when you and to be ready for every good deed. Anytime you obey what the Spirit says to you in the Word of God, you obey it, you're performing a good deed. So anything that is the result of motivation from love for God and our fellow human being, and motivated by our obedience to the Word of God, is a good deed. So here, these good deeds are to be divine in quality and character because they're in accordance with the Father's will, and they're in accordance with the Father's will because they're the direct result of a person being influenced by the Spirit. So Jesus said through the Holy Spirit, love your neighbor as yourself. Well, when we love our neighbor as ourselves, we're producing a good deed. And it could be anything that helps our neighbor. Okay? So these deeds are intrinsically valuable, intrinsically good, inherently good in quality, but with the idea of good, which is also profitable, useful, benefiting others, benevolent, because they're based upon and motivated by the teaching of the Spirit and the Word of God. So in other words, if you notice that I've said this before, Christianity is about others, not us. Sin nature, the devil saying, it's all about me. We're not to be like that. We're to be always thinking of others and thinking about how we can help them, whether it's our non-Christian neighbors. And, you know, sometimes we might not have an opportunity to actually do something for them, but we can always pray for our neighbors. I hope you pray for everybody that's in your life, people at work. You should have a prayer list. I have a prayer list. I pray for people that I went to school with in high school. I pray for people I used to work for and worked with. And don't miss this. You know, that don't forget, there are people I've prayed for. I found out years later they got saved. Well, you know, your prayers do mean a lot. So we should be, if we can't perform a good deed for somebody in our neighborhood, we can at least pray for our neighborhoods, pray for the people in our neighborhoods, pray for the people we come in contact at work with. That's very important. That's a ministry that's often overlooked in the Christian church. Prayer is powerful. You know, so every good deed, to be ready for every good deed, means we should be on the alert, ready to help a neighbor of ours in need, or people who we see that are in need and in trouble. We should be looking to help them in any way possible. Hey, that might be, you know, helping a single mom who has, maybe help her out. She's a single mom, and it might be help babysitting for her once in a while. Not raising her kid, but helping her out when she needs a babysitter or something like that. Or you see an older person they're an older couple, and, you know, it's a hot day. You should go down the street and mow their lawn. You know, say, knock on the, that's what we used to do. You know, we're taught that way. You know, anything to help people. You know, it might mean going down to a nursing home and saying, you know, and you know, singing for the nursing home people, or going out and talking to people or, you know, older people. Many of them are very lonely. And their family doesn't come and see them in these nursing homes. It could be a whole range of things. You just have to open up our eyes and see. This is what, remember, Jesus said, you're to be lights of the world. So when people think of us, they should be, as Christians, they should be thinking, you know, they're good people, because there's something about them. They're always looking to help you out and be a good neighbor. That's what we should be known as. So Titus 3:1, if you could read my translation of Titus 3:1, hopefully you have my translation in front of you. If you don't, raise your hand, and my good friend, Cheyenne Autumn Thompson, will give you one. Or my buddy, Tyler Thompson, over there. So Titus 3:1, continue to make it your habit, Titus, of reminding them, the Cretan Christian church, to voluntarily subject themselves to governmental rulers, or in other words, governmental authorities. Notice how I translate it. How do you do this? By making it their habit of being obedient, to be ready for any kind of act which is divine good and quality and character. So, as I brought this out at the beginning of class, thus far in this epistle, if you notice, Paul has been addressing matters within the church in the first two chapters, whether it is listing the qualifications for those who aspire to be to hold the office of overseer, pastor, or addressing the problems with apostate pastor teachers, or defining the duties of older and younger men and women and slaves in the Christian community. He's been talking about within the church, relationships within the church, duties within the church in the first two chapters, problems that the church is facing in the first two chapters. But you get to chapter 3, that all changes. Now in Titus chapter 3, verses 1 through 8, Paul addresses the Christian's duty outside the Christian community, and thus he goes from being concerned about the conduct of Christians in relation to each other to being concerned about their conduct in relation to the non-Christian. And why is he concerned about the Christian's conduct in relation to the non-Christian? Because he wants the non-Christian to be evangelized. So by being good citizens and good neighbors, we can lead people to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. The history is filled with instances of this taking place. The fact that Paul is telling Titus to remind the Cretan believers of their responsibilities in relation to the civil authorities implies that they were taught these responsibilities in the past by Paul and Titus. So when he says remind them, obviously the word remind means they must have been taught this before. Absolutely. Paul was very concerned that no one would think and speak badly of the gospel and thus the apostolic teaching, his apostolic teaching. Thus, he didn't want the Cretan church to become involved in civil disobedience except when justified. So remember what I said. We should never be known as lawbreakers and people who are riling trouble up. The only time we should go against our civil authorities is if they're telling us to disobey God or telling us to commit some kind of sin. Example, we're not to commit idolatry. Well, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were told to worship an image. They refused, and they were right to do that. They suffered the consequences. Paul was told by Peter and John were told not to proclaim the gospel. But they went ahead and disobeyed the governmental leaders, the Sanhedrin, and went out and preached the gospel. Let me show you that. Hold your place. Look at Acts. We saw this in our weekday class, too, interestingly enough. Look at Acts chapter 5. So you had the Gospels, then you have Romans, then 1st and 2nd Corinthians, right? But you want to go before 1st, 2nd Corinthians, and Romans. You want to go to Acts, right before Romans. So Acts chapter 5. And look at, we'll start you off at, look at verse 21, Acts 5:21. Okay, look at Acts 5:21. Upon hearing this, they entered into the temple about daybreak and began to teach. Now when the high priest and his associates came, they called the council together, even all the senate of the sons of Israel, and sent orders to the prison because for them to be brought. But the officers who came did not find them in the prison. They returned and reported back, saying, "We found the prison house locked quite securely, and the guards standing at the doors, but when we had opened up, we found no one inside." Now when the captain of the temple guard and the chief priests heard these words, they were greatly perplexed about them, so as to what would become of this act, particular act. Then he says, "But someone came and reported to them, 'The men whom you put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people.' Then the captain went along with the officers and proceeded to bring them back without violence, for they were afraid of the people, that they might be stoned. And when they had brought them, they stood them before the council, the Jewish leaders, the apostles. The high priest questioned them, saying, 'We gave you strict orders not to continue teaching in this name, and yet you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching and intend to bring this blood, man's blood upon us,'" Jesus' blood. So notice they tell him, "We told you not to teach the gospel about Jesus, that he's raised from the dead and he died on the cross for you." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than men. We must obey God rather than men." That's justified civil disobedience. Meaning, when the government, when the laws of the land, the government, conflict with the laws of God, or what God tells us to do, we're to obey God rather than the governmental leaders. We saw that in Exodus, remember? Hebrew midwives were told, "Kill those Jewish infant baby boys." That's murder. They disobeyed Pharaoh, and they did what God told them to do, and they spared those Hebrew baby boys. They didn't commit murder. That's another example of justified civil disobedience. Now, you can go back now to Titus. Titus chapter 3, verse 1. So unjustified civil disobedience, meaning we don't have biblical justification to commit civil disobedience, unjustified civil disobedience, Paul knew, would bring the apostolic teaching of the church, of the gospel, into disrepute. So the Cretan church was to render obedience to not only the emperor, but to all those serving the emperor in the Roman Empire. And in our day and age in America, that would mean from the president down to the local or town governmental leaders and local police. You should always have every respect for the police officers. Sometimes, because of people are sinners, police officers aren't the nicest people. But that doesn't mean we have a right to be disrespectful to them. So, for instance, I'll give you an example of what happened to me one time. This is a true story. It was when I was at Prairie View. I was driving to class on a Sunday morning. And I wasn't going tremendously fast. I wasn't blowing the speed, but I was breaking the speed limit. I was going too fast. Well, police officer pulls up behind me, pulls me over. I was like, oh, for crying out loud. And I had just come into Norway. So I pull over and he comes over. And he was out of line to do this. It's one thing to say, okay, here's your ticket. You broke the law. Here's your ticket. You know, but he had to give me a few choice words. He was really going beyond what he needed to go beyond. And he didn't give me a ticket, by the way. I just sat there and took it. And I said, "I apologize for doing that. I was breaking the law by going speeding." Very polite. Sometimes you just let them, you know, say what they have to say. But I didn't snap back and go, I've seen people go at a police officer. And you know what? The guy probably, I'll guarantee you, he didn't give me a ticket because I was respectful to him. Even though he was out of line for some of the things he was saying to me. But I kept my mouth shut. Okay, so that's an example, and I'm supposed to be an example for you, of not driving, blowing the speed limit away, disrespect. That's how I got in trouble to stop with. But I should be an example of, okay, that's how you should follow. Don't do what I did about the driving thing. But I learned my lesson from that. But, you know, when I give you the example of how to deal with police officers and they pull you over, be polite. Don't be a wise guy, because you're going to get you're going to get ticketed, or he might even arrest you for something. So be respectful to them. So, and you also be praying for them. For instance, I pray for the Marion police all the time. Marion police have done me a lot of good since I've been in Marion. They've helped me out big time with some of my crazy neighbors I've had. So, you know, we complain sometimes, you know, people complain about the police, but the police are there when you need them a lot of times when you do have trouble, and you're thankful that they are there. So we should pray for them. They have, let me tell you this, I know police officers. My cousin was a police officer and actually had to leave the police force, which he loved, back in Norwood, Massachusetts, because he was jumped in a trying to break up a barroom brawl. You know, and he hurt his back, and he's been in terrible pain for like 20 years now. And because he's serving us, the public. And now he can't even work. He's in disability. He's had back surgeries. It's terrible. So I know, and I have I knew another person who's a captain over in Newport Police. And they see a lot of stuff that you and I don't see. You know, they deal with the drugs, and they see the child abuse, and they see all the stuff, the bad side of people. Kind of, a lot of way like pastors, because a lot of times us pastors see the bad side of people and their families. We see the bad things that are going on, because usually people, they'll call their pastor when they're in trouble and there's a big tragedy or a crisis. And it's always these crazy things that you get. That's part of what happens. Police officers, in a lot of ways, are the same thing. They see the bad side of life. They see the bad side of people quite a bit. So that's something, you know, we should pray for them, because they need it. So obeying governmental authorities, people, would involve obeying the laws of the land, and would also include paying one's taxes and conducting oneself in public in an orderly manner. Not being troublemakers in public, you know. You see college kids do that. You know, they're out there running around drunk, and they're setting, you know, they have, you know, the Red Sox win the World Series, and they're, you know, burning cars and celebration. I don't know how that works, but they're drunks, and they're looking for a thing to cause problems, some of these people. We don't have to be like those people. We don't have to be out there, you know, running around and defacing public property or breaking the law in different ways. So Christians in America should be obeying and showing respect for every local, state, and governmental official, since Paul, as we saw in Romans 13, teaches that they are all God's servants, whether they recognize it or not. Paul is teaching in Titus 3:1 that all Christians should be law-abiding citizens and not anarchists, or those who speak evil of their leaders and complain about them. Anarchists, we had a problem with the anarchists, and we still have them around today, in the early 20th century. In fact, an anarchist shot McKinley. President McKinley in the very beginning of the 20th century was shot and killed by an anarchist. They don't believe in government. They don't think government should be around. Of course, you know where that's coming from, that idea, Satan himself. Titus 3:1 echoes Romans 13:1, as we saw, because like the former, in the latter, Romans 13, Paul issues a command for his Christian readers to continue making it their habit of voluntarily subjecting themselves to the governmental authorities. Now, the Bible, as I said before, does teach that there's certain circumstances in which the Christian is justified in disobeying the governmental authorities. Remember, the Bible says Christians are commanded to obey their Lord, their God, and they're also called upon to obey the governmental authorities. However, civil disobedience becomes an issue for the Christian when these two claims upon the Christian come into conflict, meaning when God commands us to do something like proclaim the gospel and teach the word of God, and the civil authorities prohibit this. As we saw in Acts chapter 5, the solution to this conflict is that the Christian is to obey God, as we saw in Acts chapter 5 with Peter and John. And in that passage, the apostles were commanded by the Jewish authorities to not proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, and Peter told them, we must obey God rather than men. In 1 Timothy 2, 1 through 8, as we saw, Paul urgently requests that corporate prayer be made by the Ephesian church on behalf of all those in authority. If you notice, those, when we were in our prayer meeting, Titus always prays for the president and the governmental authorities, the military. You should always pray for the military. They're in authority too. Can't forget them. We always pray for the governmental authorities, from the president on down. That's what we're supposed to do. And what did Paul say in 1 Timothy 2? You ought to give thanks for these people. These people are there by God, put there by God as his servants to protect us so that we could lead a tranquil and quiet life. Now, if you notice, the force of what Paul writes in Romans 13 and Titus 3:1, and the force of his request in 1 Timothy 2 is greatly increased as a result of understanding that the tyrant Nero was ruling Rome at this time. I always like to use this with Christians who are always speaking evil of President Obama or when President Bush was in office because they're a Democrat. When Paul says these things in Romans 13 and Titus 3 and 1 Timothy 2, Nero was on the throne in Rome. This guy, as I said before, eventually ended up murdering Paul and other Christians. He was a son of a gun. He was one of the worst rulers of history. Yet Paul says to do this. Obey them. Pray for them. Why? God desires all men to be saved. He wanted Nero to get saved. So if we don't have that kind of leader in our country right now. Trust me, President Obama is not killing Christians right now. In fact, I've listened to interviews with President Obama, and he says that he's a believer in Jesus Christ and the resurrection and the atonement. I mean, I don't know how more explicit you can be than that. I'm just saying that. So I don't know what the deal is with people out here. You know, even if he wasn't, our attitude should be one of respect for the guy. That's why when he comes out, remember his first address, I don't care if he's a Democrat as president or he's a Republican. When he's speaking, you show respect for him. It's just like you show respect for the pastor. But what happened in the 60s, and you heard me say this before, in the 60s, all this rebellion against authority took place. You know, the Vietnam War, you know, Johnson, the assassinations, the sexual revolution, all this thing. And what authority was attacked in the home, whether it was the attack of the wife attacking her husband's authority, or the children rebelling against their parents, or the citizens rebelling against their leaders. That's what we had going on in the 60s and the 70s, and we're bearing the fruit of it today. We don't have respect for our leaders. Christians, we should be we don't have to like what our leaders are doing. Okay? We don't have to like their policies. We're talking about two different things. We're talking about respect for them. We should have great respect for them, and we should be praying for them. So if you notice in Titus 3:1, Paul not only wanted the Cretan believers to obey their governmental leaders and all those in authority, but they were to be prepared for any kind of act which is divine good, meaning the result of obedience to the Spirit's teaching and the Word of God. So therefore, since this command is used in relation to the Christian's responsibility in relation to civil authority, good works here, to be ready for every good deed, good works, good deeds, should not be performed exclusively within the Christian community, but outside the Christian church, namely in the community in which they live. So a good deed could be helping your neighbor to get dig out from the rubble of a tornado, or babysitting the single mom's child for a couple of hours. It could be anything like that, helping an older person mow their lawn, go see somebody in the nursing home. You know, looking out to help people in need. Good deeds are not just related to with each other as Christians, but to outside of our community. And of course, this is an evangelistic thing we're talking about here. So we see here that Paul is teaching that Christians have a responsibility to be good citizens who help their communities in which they live. Thus, it means you and I have civic responsibilities. So by obeying Paul's orders here in Titus 3:1, the Cretan Christian community would stand in stark contrast to the unsaved Cretan culture, because in the ancient world, the Cretans were notorious in the Roman Empire as those who were constantly involved in insurrections against the government as well as murders. So the Cretans, their society in Crete, they were notorious in the Roman Empire for being lawbreakers. Rebelling against Rome, they were always getting involved in insurrections. They murdered people in authority. And Paul saying what he says in Titus 3:1, he wants the Cretan Christian community to be in stark contrast to those people in Cretan culture who were non-Christians, who were lawbreakers. The Cretans were notorious as always rebelling against authority of all types. And in fact, they hated being subjugated to the Roman Empire. Furthermore, and we'll close with this, by obeying Paul's commands, the Cretan Christian church would stand in stark contrast with the Judaizers. Remembering Paul says in Titus 1:16 that these people were worthless ones for any kind of divine good work of intrinsic quality and character. Meaning those Judaizers, because they taught false doctrine and lived by false doctrine, they're worthless for any kind of good deed. You ought to be different, he's saying to the Cretan Christian church, than them. So this is what I say to you in closing. We should be law-abiding citizens who are looking out to help our communities in which we live. We should be respectful to all authority, whether it's the police officer up to the president. We should be those type of people, because that will make us, first of all, it will lead people to possibly a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. By operating as good citizens and ready to perform any good deed, we're going to stand in stark contrast to the world. A lot of non-Christians are not like that, obviously. There are some that are, but we're going to stand out and for good. And that's how we are to be lights of the world. Remember Jesus talked about that? That's how you do it. Not just being a good Christian and serving your fellow Christian, and learning your Bible and obeying your Bible and showing up to Bible class when your church is assembling and praying with your church. Okay, well, we have that responsibility. But we also have a responsibility to the non-Christian, to civil authorities. We should be lights in the world in our communities. And that's going to draw people to the Savior, not just simply talking about the gospel. Like, some people are not going to want to listen to you talk about it, but they can see you the way you are as a good neighbor. They can see the way you treat other people. They can see that you're very helpful and a law-abiding citizen. How they can't say anything bad about you. That's good. Maybe they'll think about becoming a Christian because of you and I and our good behavior. So hopefully this will be a great blessing, this class. And my prayer is that would be a great blessing to the body of Christ, and also bring glory to our Lord. So, Father, let's pray, everyone, for a closing prayer here. Father, we thank you for this time to study your word. We thank you for everyone that is here this morning. We pray that they would have received their necessary spiritual nourishment. We pray there would be a great blessing to them. Help them to apply these things in their communities and in their relationship to the authorities. And we just pray for our authorities, Father. We lift up our president. We pray, Father, for the military, the local governmental officials, state, federal, those in other paramilitary organizations, not just the police, but those who are FBI or different security organizations in our country. We pray for them. We pray that you give our leaders the wisdom and the moral courage to lead this country. We pray that you would expose them to the gospel, whether it's for their salvation or their spiritual growth as believers, if they're already believers. We thank you for all of our governmental leaders, and we thank you for the establishment of government, Father. And we pray, Father, that our church would become a great light in this community that which we live in here in Cedar Rapids, the Marion area. So, Father, we pray for these things in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ's name. Amen. All right, we're going to take up our Sunday morning offering, and I'm going to sing us a song. And it's on page 167, There Ain't No One Like Jesus Christ My Lord. And remember, we have a little brunch afterwards that Jody prepared for us, and we thank you, Jody, for always doing that for us. And thank you for everyone who has contributed some food here today as well and in the past. Thank you for doing that. It's always, I think it's one of the great things about our little church here is I really enjoy that afterwards. Get to know you guys, spend some time with you. And a lot of times in churches, people go in and out, and that's their right. They can, you know, people have things going on But it's nice to be able to hang out and have fellowship afterwards and see where you guys are at and stuff and pray with you guys. All right, let's pray for this offering. Father, we pray that this offering would bring glory to you and your Son, Jesus Christ. We pray that it would provide for our needs. We thank you for those who have taken part in the giving. We just thank you for their faithfulness and their love that they've demonstrated to the body of Christ. We pray that they would give out of proper motivation, out of love for your word, and what's being taught here, and also love for you and your Son, Jesus Christ, who this ministry is serving. We just pray, Father, that it would also produce many thanksgiving to you, this offering. And again, we thank you for the great privilege that you have given to us to demonstrate our good stewardship with our finances. We thank you, Father, for the finances that you have given to us, the jobs, the salaries that we have, and so that we might be able to help your cause here in the devil's world, getting the gospel of your Son, Jesus Christ, out to a lost and dying world. In our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ's name, we pray. Amen. Where ain't no one like Jesus Christ.